So, what's unusual about this blood smear? So we have a blood smear, but what is weird? I mean, we see these type of cells. They look like what? What type of formed element? But notice that are all of them shaped this way? Yeah, the regular shaped blood cells. Yeah, so notice that some of these red blood cells, they do look like the donuts, right? This biconcave, but now we have some red blood cells, they have unusual shapes. Yeah, someone described it as a crescent moon, and this is correct. So this is what we call sickle cell anemia. So sickle cell anemia, remember that normal blood cells, they're round, but they have the double dimple, so this is our biconcave. They look like a inner tube that has its inner. Like instead of having a complete hole in it, it still has a little membrane in between it. So the interesting thing is that sickle cell anemia is caused by a single mutation. So remember that nucleic acids, including DNA, they have that sequences of these nucleotides that encode the information to make a protein. Just by changing one of those letters, those nucleotides, this causes hemoglobin to become mutated in certain some individuals. And this is normal hemoglobin, so this is kind of like those four blobs we saw in the previous lectures. But when you have that mutation, instead of forming this globe, so this is another way to think of it, like hemoglobin should be like a globe, it should be kind of roundish. But in sickle cell hemoglobin, what happens is that it becomes elongated, so it starts looking, it forms fiber instead of being a tangled up ball. So if you have these fibers being formed, well, it's like think of it like if you stuffed a water balloon full of marbles versus a water balloon stuffed with chopsticks. But the one stuffed with sticks is then going to become elongated and pokey and stiffer, right? So the thing is that these elongated cells block blood flow. So again, here we have our normal red blood cells up here. But these abnormal sickle cells, notice that they're kind of forming a log jam. And not only that, when they're jammed up like that, if you have a sickle cell like this, well, again, they're made of cell membranes, so they can kind of break apart like that. So sickle cells, they flow less efficiently, and they're also more prone to breaking up as well. So sickle cells are also more fragile, and hemolysis is going to cause all those contents to rupture as well. So this is why sickle cell, but why does it cause anemia? Because of this fragility. So if this is these red blood cells are being broken up, you don't have the hemoglobin being transported efficiently in your blood, thereby causing this anemia. All right, so then why do we see sickle cell? So if this is causes all this anemia, why do we have this problem? Well, it's an interesting thing, and I'm sure if you're a bio major, you're definitely going to cover this at one point, because people, when especially when they talk about heterozygote, like genetics and evolution, they'll talk about this. Like people who are carriers for this sickle cell trait, they're more resistant to malaria. So the parasite that causes malaria, it has a hard time replicating in sickle cells than normal red blood cells. So yeah, and this is why we often see it more common in our African American population. Why? Because due to ancestry in Africa, you see that this sickle cell trait is more frequent in people who have genetics and the genetic background from this area. But again, because these sickle cells are harder for this parasite to replicate, as seen by this, so this is where we find incidences of malaria. This is why it's advantageous there. But again, if you're trying to do a endurance sport and you have a double dose of the sickle cell anemia, well, you're going to have lower hematocrit because of your more fragile sickle cell traits. And actually, like there's many things sickle cells can lead to. And this is why, this is why we often have to screen this, especially with people who have ancestry from this area. But it's not just Africa too. So notice that we have some in India and the Mediterranean and also the Arabian Peninsula as well. So again, it's not just limited to Africans. All right, so then we have anemia. So that's low hematocrit, right? Can you have too many red blood cells? And the answer is yes, you can have too many red blood cells. And the term for it is polycythemia. So if you have elevated hematocrit. So many things can cause polycythemia, but things like dehydration. It's just like what happens if you have too much or if you're dehydrated? What happens to the concentration of sodium and glucose in your blood? Well, it's going to go up. So dehydration can also cause your overall volume of red blood cells to go up because you have more cells and less fluid. Another thing is that you can have high EPO, like you know who, or like all those Tour de France dopers. They took a lot of the EPO. They have a lot by taking a lot of EPO. They have more red blood cells, therefore higher hematocrit. But then there's a condition called polycythemia vera. So vera, from the Latin term for like veracity and truth. So vera is true. So what happens is that these blood stem cells, and again, we covered how we make those erythrocytes in the previous lecture. But what you have is like too many of these red blood cells being produced, and you have low EPO. This is the difference between this and blood doping, is that your kidneys sense that, okay, we have a lot, we're not having a lack of oxygen, we're not having hypoxia, so, and we have a lot of red blood cells, so we have enough oxygen, we don't need to make EPO. But for due to this proliferation of the blood stem cells, this is why they have a lot of red blood cells. Now, you might be thinking, well, is it good to have, so is this necessarily a bad condition? Well, the way I like to describe it is like think of it like a soup. So if you like a if you're like me, when I like making soup, I like making it like especially any sort of like chunky soup. I like making it like so much of the fillings and good fixings that are solid that it's almost like when you stick your spoon in, it stands straight up. So the thing is that as you add more cells, it also literally thickens your blood as well. And if you have all these red blood cells colliding with each other, well, maybe that's going to cause them more prone to rupture. And yeah, so you can have your blood becoming too thick from a very high hematocrit. But this is a rare condition. That's why I italicized it. So it is possible to have too high hematocrit. So like everything in your body. Yeah, maybe having it around that 60% for that Tour de France guy was advantageous for endurance sport, but you don't want a really high hematocrit where it starts causing problems due to hemolysis or problems with circulation as well.